Planning Committee. You may be aware that a long-standing council member, Walter Smith, passed away recently, and I would like to be grateful if you would oblige me in standing for 1 minute silence as a mark of respect. Thank you. Thank you. Good evening again, everybody. My name is Councillor Anita Leach and I'm the chair of this committee. My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people on the tables here tonight are, to my immediate right is the council solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on any procedural or legal matters that might arise. To my left are the council's planning officers, highway engineer and environmental health officer, who will present the applications this evening and give any technical advice to the committee that might be sought. The rest of the people you see down both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualifying petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the residents. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gallery, they may not return to take part in any debate that may follow by the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee, then that matter will not be discussed this evening. And if there is an application for a site visit and it's approved, I'll give people time to leave and they can leave at that point. Okay? Thank you. So, committee, can I have approval for the minutes of page 1 to 10, please?
Yes, Chair, thank you.
Thank you. I'll go to sign them later on. Okay, members' code of conduct, are there any declarations of interest? David?
Yep. Yes, thank you, Chair. Item 12, which is land adjacent to 15 Heron Road, I need to declare sort of personal potential trepidation just in the fact that I have known the chief objector for over 20 years, and I don't think it's right for me to make a decision on the building.
Eddie?
Exactly the same.
Okay, thank you. Okay, anybody else? Okay, I might need to declare an interest in agenda item 14, which is an item for for noting the brownfield, registered brownfield land. My reason for declaring an interest is that I'm a board member of Prima Board and Prima Liso Community Homes, which are listed as landowners on that list. As I say, it is only for noting, so I will be able to agree that. Okay? All right then, moving on to site visits. Do we have any requests for site visits, please? David?
Yes, thank you again, Chair. I'm moving actually for three site visits. One is item four, Boiling Presbyterian Church. I think the nature and of the development is such that we can really only make a rational decision by seeing the site. That's item four. Item nine, which is of course the Shepherd's Close and Corrupa development. Similar, I believe that the site is such that we do again need to see the site before making a decision on which way to go with this. And finally, it is item 11, Land Lane West, which has some quite severe implications for local residents that I really believe they need to be assessed by looking at the site. So I'm moving for those three items, Chair. That's item 4, item 9, and item 11.
Okay, could I have committee's approval to have site visits for 4, 9 and 11? Okay, just for the purpose of people who are here this evening. So agenda item 4 is Hoylake Presbyterian Church. We've then got agenda item 5, which is Stoughton Hall Farm, which we've actually delayed until the next meeting if anybody has turned up for that meeting. Then we've got agenda item 9, 3 Shepherd's Close, Greasby, which will be a site visit, and agenda item 11, which is 11 Lamb Lane, West Kirby. So if anybody is here for those applications, we will be doing the site visits on the 12th of December, and we normally start those at 10:15, but there will be notifications about that. So if anybody does want to leave who's here for those applications, please feel free to do so now. Thank you for your attendance.
In a way, it's constructive. In relation to its focus on life. But is it possible to actually commit to make the right decisions?
If I could ask you to leave as quickly as possible, please, you can continue conversations outside.
Drop a water, thank you.
Okay, members, we are going to move on to agenda item 6, which is pages 53 to 60 in your pack. And when we're ready, can you have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair. The application before members is a departure from the rules of future development plan. This application is for the change of use of a vacant industrial unit into a gym. The site is located within the Arrow Commercial Park, and of the 18 units within the park, 7 are currently vacant. 7 objections have been received. Itself, however, the enforcement officer has not found any evidence of this today. The application's been assessed against UDP policy EM8, which addresses, which defines within the industrial areas, only uses falling within use classes B1, B2 and 8 will be permitted. However, the National Planning Policy Framework states that health and fitness centres are main town centre uses and substantial tests should be undertaken. Furthermore, the NPPF also states that planning policies should avoid large-term protection of sites allocated for employment uses where there is no reasonable prospect of that site being used for that purpose. Within the core strategy, policies state that alternative uses on land designated for industrial purposes will be considered, providing the site has been continually marketed for employment uses for the last 12 months. An ongoing supply of employment land would be retained, and the proposed use is compatible with surrounding uses within the area, and the proposed use has been subject to a town centre subvention test. And the existing businesses within that particular unit have applied for a source of grant funding. The applicant has provided evidence to say that unsuitable sites within the immediate locale have not been suitable due to their size and ceiling height. Marketing evidence has been provided from the agents along with vacancy rates within the area. Rural Chamber of Commerce have also confirmed that there are no start-up funding available or not all grants available. So for these reasons, the proposal is considered to be acceptable, subject to the attached conditions.
Okay, can I ask, is there a more councillor here to speak on this? No, okay, can I put this up to committee, please?
I am concerned about this application. I'm always a little bit concerned whether a change of land use, if you like, designation being proposed. It's an industrial site, and the application is to change it to a D2 use. And I understand the policy context, but I've noted in the report that it came with objections. I made some inquiries about the nature of the objection. And the objections emanate from similar business use being moved to the shit outside the town centre. And their objection obviously is one of the competition. And I've absolutely no objection to competition, but we don't have in this country unfettered competition. We have level playing fields, but we have level playing fields to ensure that everything done is fair. Now, in this case, we're proposing to, or the application proposes, to introduce competition in an area not designated to take that competition. The competition, if you like, ought to be in the Upton area or the Greasby area, so, or anywhere within, if you like, the what is the cost strategy called? Settlements, anywhere in those settlements. And I was drawn to of course, strategy policy, proposed policy CS8, which deals with priorities for the townships there. And policy 4 was to safeguard and enhance the viability of the local centres of Upton and Greasby, etc. Now, objections have been received that if we were to allow the change of use, that it might impact on the businesses that are currently in. If you like, the correct place, the land use in the Upton centre, shopping centre, is geared for commercial use. These are industrial use units, and the proposal is to change that designation so that we're also taking that commercial use, and that will impact, as the objection seems to be, not from the report, from the inquiries that I've previously made. That makes me more nervous than I would normally be. The last reason I was nervous, if you like, about a change of use in Bromborough, which is the premier industrial site. Changing that to particular issue just struck me as, again, outside our policy framework. This one concerns me even more, which is why I'm going to put possibly even more, because it's attracted objections tax on people who are playing the game of their business in the area designated to be used for commercial use. And our objection is, yes, it will have a competitive, it will raise a competitive issue for them, but my feeling is they are right to be concerned where we are changing the playing field, changing the openness, right? So we're quite prepared to move away from industrial designation to allow that competition to take place. I think that's wrong. I think we ought to defend the policy position that we have. And the distance between Upton and Fiera Park industrial units is 790 metres. So we are introducing competition where it would not reasonably have been expected by any other developer that such competition would be introduced as straight away as a unfair.
Okay, do
any
planning officers want to come back on that as well?
Just, I suppose, to say that there was a condition, again, limiting the use to a 10-year plan permission. The proposal does comply with a large majority of the policies set out in the course of action in the National Planning Policy Framework. I think that's all the stage. What I wanted to say.
Denise?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I just think, I don't believe it's only 750 metres from...
I'm crossing from the report.
I mean, because obviously we've done this several times on Bromborough industrial estate, so you can't, I know each application is taken on its own merits, so I think you need to go with that and take this on its own merits as well.
Okay, anybody else? Pat?
Yeah, as Denise says, we have had similar cases in the recent past. I think the point here is there's a clear anti-competitive bias. Give one operator a competitive advantage over other operators who have already established a business, I think that is unfair competition. And I agree with Stuart.
Okay, Pat?
Yeah, just a couple of points. I mean that's all very well and good, some of the comments that have been made. But that's in the context that the area is thriving and there's a lot going on, which quite clearly there isn't. As we can see from it, because out of 18 industrial units, it says here on page 56, within this park, 7 are vacant. Surely it's beholden on us as well, as a council, to look at other uses as well. And surely this is only in the short term, not in the long term. It's actually said, it's part of the recommendation, it's in the short term. So if at some stage they can attract more investment for employment uses and the uses that it's deemed, within this area, all well and good. And also, well, there's a bit of animation in the place and bring jobs. And those people, you know, use facilities around the area to find money. So I fully agree with the recommendation to approve it.
Thank you, Chair. I think that one of the problems we've got is that having already approved similar situations in the past, we'd be accused of being inconsistent if we didn't approve this one, particularly when clearly efforts with employment land viability and town centre sequential test and all the rest of it have been done. They are vacant units, and we wouldn't normally consider competition to be a valid or reason for refusal. So I'm uneasy about trying to use that as a reason, quite honestly, although I fully understand Stuart's point on this. The other thing that we ought to remember is that condition 6 on page 59 does say the use thereof shall be permitted, as we've done in the past, shall be discontinued and the building restored to its former condition on or before 10 years of the approval date in accordance with the scheme of work to be submitted. And that means we can enable assessment of the effects of development on the amenities of the character of the area. So we have got a bit of a fail-safe sort of situation there. And they've put in a valid application, they seem to have done all the right things for the situation, and I don't believe that we can honestly, understand where you're coming from, but I honestly don't believe we can take the impact on existing businesses as a reason for refusal, because that would create precedents which I would want to try and justify or defend in the future.
Thank you, David.
Denise?
Yeah, because I agree with Stuart, and I think that
the
condition Approval, Chair. The officer's recommendation. Have you not finished?
Sorry, I just wanted to come back on to you. There were just 2 points made, which I was questioned to, which I'd just like to address. First one from Pat about viability. He makes a fair point potentially if the viability of the Upton industrial units is our priority. However, the priority that's outlined in the core strategy is about the viability of the Upton shopping centre. Now, the competition that will potentially go to allow by moving in the direction of change of land use designation could very well impact on the existing businesses in the right area, in the commercial zone. And if they were to move out, then there would be less money being spent in the shops in the commercial area, and that's the land use designation. Which leads me on to David's question about what grounds we got for refusal. Well, it's a land change. This is why it's here. The grounds for refusal is that you can't have a commercial activity in an area that's designated for industrial use. It's, the onus is actually on them to persuade us that the change of land use is acceptable to us given the policies. Now, that's what I'm putting forward, that the change of use from industrial to commercial is detrimental to the land use designations that we have for. And that's, if you like, the reason for the potential reason for refusal. But if Denise wants to move at this juncture approval, then clearly we can test the will of the committee. And if people aren't minded to approve, then I'll put forward some words that we can vote on.
Okay, I've got the hands up there. Unless you're going to move refusal on this. I'm going to move to the fact that Denise moved approval. Okay. Were you going to move refusal? No. Okay. So Denise has moved approval. Do we have a seconder? Pat, all those in favour of approval? And those against? Okay, that's carried. Thank you. Okay, if we can now move on to agenda item 7, please. That's pages 61 to 66 of your packs. 63 Grange Road, West Kirby. Do you have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair. This application has basically two elements to it. First of all, it's a two-story rear extension to the existing property, which is a semi-detached house. And also it's a change of use of that property then into two flats. It's a semi-detached property in a primarily residential area on Grange Road in West Kirby. There's planning history which is quite relevant to the site. Earlier this year we approved a two-storey extension to build a house, so it's a house extension, and the proposals that are before you now are virtually identical visually to that extension that was approved. The difference being that on the front of the site where there was a garage door is now changed to two doorways to access the flats. So there are sort of two implications in the proposal. The first is the physical implication of it on surrounding properties, and the second is the use. So in terms of the visible implication, it's a two-storey extension which runs along parallel, continues the rear elevation of the property and extends to the side. It's two-storey and it's got dormers in the roof as well, as had the one that they approved for a house extension earlier in the year. So the layout of the development would then be a ground floor flat and an upper floor flat that has an extra bedroom and living space. So when we looked at the application for a house extension earlier in the year, we looked at the distance between the rear of the elevation of the extension and the garden of One Ashburton Road, which is at the top of the site. The existing house is about 10 metres away from the rear boundary, or the side boundary of that property, which is the rear boundary of the application site, which is what we normally look for. The extension at that time was 8 metres away, which is slightly short of the distance we would normally expect to see. It was felt at the time, had no objections to the proposal, and because it looked across the garden, towards the back of the garden, over outbuildings that were in the adjacent property, that there was no direct view into the garden until you got to about 10 metres away, so it was adequate. So we approved it, and there was a first floor bedroom window and two dormer windows. The current proposal now still has a window on the rear elevation of the extension at first floor, but this is a dressing room window, so in some sense it's better than the approval that was granted for a house extension, because it's not a habitable room window. The dormer windows are the same, and then there's an ensuite bathroom on the extension part of the roof, and then there's a bedroom window on the dormer on the existing dormer, which was as approved again earlier in the year. So in terms of the physical impact of the extension, it's no worse than was previously approved in February, and in some ways it's better because a bedroom window is turned into a dressing room window. In terms of the use of the building, it's in a residential area. It's a very sustainable location on the way to West Kirby Town Centre. There is parking already in the front garden, it's all hard surface virtually, so you can still get a couple of cars off the road. There is a rear garden to provide bike storage, bin storage if necessary, and it is in a residential area where the back conversions are encouraged and supported to reach the policy. We feel that this is a sustainable location where this kind of development can take place, and it is recommended for approval on that basis. There is a qualified petition.
Thank you. Is the lead petitioner here to speak on this? Would you like to come forward?
Yes.
If you just take the seat there should be a button on the bottom of the microphone. Can you switch that on?
Hello.
If I could just ask you to say your name and address and tell you that you have up to 5 minutes to speak. And I'll let you know when you have 1 minute
then. Okay, that's great. Thank you. Name is Peter Fitzgerald. I live in number 65 Wayne's Road, which is the adjacent adjoined property to number 63 at the applicant site. To start with, the applicant, as been detailed by the planning officer, had approved planning for an extension basically to accommodate a dependent relative, which we all went along with as neighbours. Detrimental to us because the uses were just bedrooms at first and second floor. The meeting after that was approved, this went through a minor approval. The applicant applied for what you see in front of you now, which is a subdivision of the house into initially they wanted three flats and the plans were talking down to two flats. Obviously, this is a game changer from our point of view. It's a intensification of use of the first and second floor level that wasn't intended within the original application. It's contrary to the actual initial proposal from the use point of view. The impact on amenity and of neighbours is quite significant and overlooking. The planning report, as I read it, supported based on the overriding provisions of NPPF, I'm not going to tell you what that is, you know what it is, supporting sustainable housing developments and presumption in favour of it in a sustainable location. And they're quite satisfied in regards to our adopted policy as regards compliance with overlooking and amenity issues in principle to number one Ashburton Road. That's what the report majors on. And also the introduction of a condition only in part for one room to be soundproofed adjacent to a bedroom to number 65, that's my house of course. The actual identified room being the kitchen and sort of dining area. All of the matters such as character, density, parking, and I'll just throw aside basically because it's supposed to be sustainable. Sustainable development depends on the application being within 400 metres of the main service area or core area of an area, including the nodes of transport, shops, therefore, everything else. The definition of policy is measured, not to be measured in a as the crow flies situation. This particular site stands on the Browder Hill up from the flat part of West Kirby. It's in a sustainable location, if you measure 400 metres from where it is, yeah? The chip shop's 2 minutes away. great stuff. But if you're in a wheelchair, and that's what the further definition than policy takes into consideration, you won't push yourself up that hill unless you've been in the Invictus Games. Right, so things like car parking is important. Things like the policy provisions that are enshrined in our policy that we've evolved over years to protect against what I'd call a subservient type of development are important. Just can't be thrown away. The actual car parking in this particular location is 3 cars parked at the moment of the boat stuffed in for good measure. It's envisioned 2 dwellings, it's going to be at least 2 car parking. Spokes to the dwelling, because it's not conceivable someone's going to be walking all over the place. They are going to have cars. The market for these 2 flats is going to be expensive flats.
Mr.
Fitzgerald, you have 1 minute left. Okay. Policy states, backed up by MPPF, dwellings should not result in a significant loss of privacy for neighbouring properties. There's no mention of overlooking to number 65's garden or of the Stone Height garden. For some reason, that's just been totally overlooked. There's no real mention of the problems of the way that the development has been reached, that they've got a kitchen area above a bedroom, and within policy that's stacked incorrectly. They've got kitchen and living rooms adjacent to bedrooms, my bedrooms. That's not correct within policy. This has been through and consulted with all the local neighbours. It's not a petition that's been signed by Mickey Mouse. All local people here. It's not a character. Everybody cannot see the positive side of this. And for this to go through, it has to have an enhancement of the quality and character of the area and make a positive contribution.
Mr. Fitzgerald, I had something
thank you very much. That's all I wanted to see.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. Is the applicant or agent here? Would you like to come forward to speak?
Good evening. Mark Jackson, I'm the applicant. I'm here with my wife.
Okay, could I ask you to turn your microphone on? And again, you have up to 5 minutes to speak. And I'll let you know when you've got to leave there. Thank you.
My name's Mark Jackson, I'm the applicant, I'm here with my wife. Peter's got an enormous, Peter, my neighbour, has got an enormous petition together objecting to this. But in my conversations with my neighbours, I can't find any objections to the immediate neighbours. It seems that my neighbours canvassed almost the whole of the local area, all the streets, they've even canvassed in the local pub. To get signatories to object to my application, which appears to be, as far as you know, the planning officer seems to be perfectly reasonable. We did initially apply for an extension to the rear of the garage and to extend it and then into the loft. It's not actually, it doesn't extend the width of the property or anything, it just sort of fills in a corner at the back of the house. And that was approved without any objection, and the planning officer, Stephanie, approved the when we decided that we wanted to house an elderly member of the family in a separate accommodation within the property rather than as part of the big building. Peter's mentioned that our application impacts on Wyashburton Road, but I'm good friends and acquaintances with the people at Wyashburton Road, and in conversations with them, they have no objections whatsoever. Although when the petition was put in the one of their notices in the pub, they did sign it by mistake, not realising what the implications were. So I feel that this petition's been put together to object to it in a sort of underhanded and irrelevant way. One of the things that the petitioner mentioned was that we're on the brow of a hill. We're not on the brow of a hill, we're on a slope of a hill, and our application for this application doesn't involve any of the neighbours other than the gardens, as the planning officers have already mentioned. I won't take up any more of your time, I just want to clarify a few.
Councillor Geoffrey Rockhurst here, the Thurston Ward. And to appreciate, I have no wish to come between neighbours on this one. But I have to say, I'm very saddened that an application like this is becoming come before your committee. I really wonder how low our expectations are in rural, how low we've sunk, that you should be recommended to approve this kind of creeping development. This house is not some large Victorian Edwardian villa desperately in need of division. This is a medium-sized 1930s semi amongst a lot of properties of a similar size. And although it's been said that it's near the town centre and therefore development, and you can argue about whether it's on the brow of a hill or on a slope, it is actually on the steep slope out of West Kirby, up above the steepest part of the slope, which was the reference to the Invictus Games given earlier. If you are out of West Kirby Centre, the chances are you are not going to easily get down into the town centre. You're very likely going to find some means of transport, and you may be going there or elsewhere. You're talking here about making two units where there were one, so you're very likely talking about two or more vehicles. This is already a very, very difficult gateway to get out of because of its situation. Close to a junction, right again up against a light controlled crossing, which was put there because it's a main route between schools where there used to be a whip on person. It is very, very difficult to maneuver in and out of there because of the continuous nature of the traffic and the volume of the traffic out on the slope. You frequently discuss the number of parking spaces required. I and others I know think that Wirral's parking standards, providing maximum parking standards, are an absolute joke. And in this position, they really, really need to be disregarded and something other than this being allowed. There's no provision for turning within the site. It really should not be allowed. You also need to be aware, if you're not, on your front cover of your report, the plan shows a big bare front garden next to the site, in front of the house called Stonehive. You remember that some of you went on a site visit not long ago before you approved a very much opposed additional dwelling put in that garden. Also, I think some of you noticed when you were at that site visit, the very large detached house put in the garden across the road. This area has suddenly been heavily developed, and I really don't think that doing this is going to add to the amenity of the area. I don't think it helps the sustainability. I don't think it's within the spirits of the National Planning Policy Framework. You've heard doubts mentioned about the separation distances. Apparently, it's thought that if it doesn't comply, it's near enough, so it doesn't matter. I think it does matter. You should be worried about overlooking. You should be looking about putting more units where there really isn't a good reason to put more units. And I hope you will find a reason to refuse this application. Thank you.
Thank you, Geoffrey. Can I open this up to the committee, please? Can we come to you, Chair? I have to say that when I was reading the support of the project quite the strength of the planning application for an extension and then suddenly decide to make it into two dwelling units. I was having an extension on my house. I think if I was then not going to live there, I'd sell it as opposed to change it into two flats. I think the other issue is it changes the dynamics of the living accommodation for people that are living next door. Living in a semi-detached house, the bedrooms are upstairs, generally, the living accommodation is downstairs. But if one part of that semi-detached then has living accommodation upstairs, like a kitchen and living area, then the people next door, when they go to bed, are potentially going to be listening to the television, kettle boiling, clattering on floors that, generally speaking, in the kitchen would have a wooden floor as opposed to carpeting. So that's going to make more noise. If I was the neighbour, I wouldn't be very happy if my next door neighbour had done that to me.
Thank you.
we do have a condition for regarding sound. Would you like to say more about that?
Through you, Chair, yes. Following consultation with environmental protection, we have put in a condition to require sound in between the upper floors of the first floor flat and adjacent property. The room itself is a through room. The condition requires some small details of soundproofing, so I'd expect to see what comes through from that to cover down on that wall.
Okay, is there anybody else? Ian?
Can I say a general point here on this, because we've had a number of applications in recent months for this particular part of West Cambridge. I understand why, and we look at every application on its own merits. At what point do we look at the cumulative impact of all these applications? Because it does seem to me that every spare available bit of land in this part of West Cambridge is being developed, and while each application on its own is worth approval or is approved by this commission, I'm just wondering at what point or what powers we have as a committee to say, well, enough is enough overall in an area.
Through you, Chair. Just to say simply, we don't have a cumulative assessment in our flat conversion policy. So we have to assess each one on what's on site, whether it has parking, whether it has amenity space, and what's in the surrounding area. So at the minute, that's how we have to assess them.
Anybody else? David?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. As a ward councillor for this area, I share Councillor Lewis's concern about the escalation in property development in this area. It seems to be racing away like a unbridled horse in the sense that a lot of development is taking place. We've got some on the agenda for future which need to be taken again on their face value. But I'm just unhappy about this one altogether. But I can't immediately think of specific reasons for refusal that would be sustainable and appeal, although I think potentially overdevelopment, over-intensification of use might be a reason for refusal, but I have not already, have not previously formulated a specific reason for refusal. I'm not sure that I can really just ask for one on the hoof now, but I have been and am continuing to be unhappy about this particular development. I wonder whether anybody else has any similar thoughts. I'd almost like to move refusal, but I can't at the moment just think of the grounds for doing so.
Thank you, David. I think just to remind members that this planning application has been previously approved, and the officers have outlined that the changes to the exterior of the building relate to the changes of a garage door to two single doors. So, although the previous application has gone through all of those matters, including the separation distances, and we have approved that application, so you know we need to look at this application as it stands now. So, has anybody got anything else they want to add? Okay. Well, the officer's recommendation is to approve, subject to the conditions listed. Do you have any of that? Denise, do I have a seconder? Pass. All those in favour of approval? And those against? Okay, that's carried. Thank you.